You are now listening to My Works Radio. Listen to Holy Spirit talk to you. Here's your host, Evangelist King.
Praise the Lord, dear heart. Thank you for joining in today with me on Holy Spirit Talk, Deliverance, Healing, and Prayer. Today, our subject is entitled Warning Against Joblessness. Our scripture reference is coming from 2 Thessalonians, the 3rd chapter. And I'm reading from the Complete Jewish Bible, just in case it sounds a little different than yours. But the same spirit brings the same understanding, same interpretation. So it's the Complete Jewish Bible. Here the Apostle Paul is warning us about idleness. You know, I looked up the word idleness, and it does mean joblessness. So it told me that there is a demon spirit of joblessness, which is idleness, that attacked the saints of God during Paul's time while he was on the earth, as well as today. They are the same demon spirits, no new demon spirits. They're the same demon spirits doing the same evil work that they was doing when Paul was walking upon this earth. They're doing the same today. They are misleading, especially God's children, in receiving and believing that it's the will of the Lord for them to be jobless. That is a demon spirit of joblessness. Again, it attacked our brothers and sisters during Paul's time. And it's also is attacking our brothers and sisters today. So here the Holy Spirit is warning us about idleness of or joblessness. So 1 Thessalonians, the 3rd chapter, verse 1, the Apostle Paul, by the Holy Spirit, this is the Holy Spirit who actually is speaking through the Apostle Paul. Now, it amazes me that how quickly we are ready to receive demon spirits speaking through a person. But when it comes to the Holy Spirit, we don't believe that. Dear heart, remember Satan copies. He's not a creator. He's a copycat. He copies. He duplicates. But he uses it towards his evil plan, purposes, and ideals. So the Apostle Paul, by the Holy Spirit, was warning God's children concerning joblessness or idleness. He said, family brothers. He's talking about, when you see brothers, he's actually talking about brothers and sisters. You know, in the Greek, there's a word in which they use that mean brother and sisters, but it really, the true meaning is believers. So it's not a gender thing here. It's just that it's a position. The man, God created man as the head, so you can't get no higher. So therefore, it's a position. He say, family brothers. He's talking about brethren. That means sisters and brothers. So when sisters, you hear Apostle Paul said brothers, he's talking to you and I too, because we are believers. He's talking to the believers. He said, family brother, pray for us that the Lord's message may spread rapidly and receive honor just as it did with you. So we have to pray for those who are in leadership position, who's really taking a stand in a leadership role of leading and guiding God's people to truth. So we need to pray for them. And so the Holy Spirit, through the Apostle Paul, is letting the believers know in Thessalonians to pray for him, and not only him, but the other brethren who also have that leadership responsibility in leading, guiding them to Jesus Christ. So he said, pray for them that the same message that we spoke to you, that it will rapidly spread to help other people as well. So the Apostle Paul did not believe in just him being blessed or his family being blessed. He was interested in all mankind being blessed. Verse 2, he said, and that we may be rescued from wicked and evil people, for not everyone has trust. That means pray for those who are in leadership roles, who are taking a stand and leading people to all truth. Pray for them that they would not be delivered to the evil one. Pray for them to be rescued from the wicked and from evil people, because not everyone is going to believe the truth. Even with me, there's some who have heard, but they don't believe. So as the Apostle Paul, pray for me, because not everyone who hear me believe. Not everyone who hear me trust in God, believe the word of God would come forth through my mouth. They don't believe. So pray for me. Why? Because those ones who don't believe are ones who are speaking evil and do all kinds of evil against you. And also they even teach people that you are contrary to who you say you are. Instead of you being a child of God, they say you are a witch. And that's what they're saying about me. There's some who actually is spreading the word that Evangelist King is a witch. So as the Apostle Paul by the Holy Spirit said, pray for him. So dear heart, you understand my voice today. You pray for me. Verse 3, he said, but the Lord is worthy of trust. He will make you firm and guard you from the evil one. And he does. The Lord, dear heart, protects us and guard us from the evil one. You know, on yesterday I did a deliverance session of a woman from a spirit husband, and when I commanded the spirit husband to pack its load and go, did you hear I say the spirit husband to pack it load and go? See, that's what the problem is in most marriages. The wrong husband or wife is packing their load and leaving. Most likely it's the physical husband or the physical wife who packs their load and leave, while that spirit husband or that spirit wife remains. No, dear heart, in Jesus' name, command the spirit husband, spirit wife, and by faith in God, pack your load. Go. Get out now in Jesus' name. And when I commanded that, you know, God is gracious. He's merciful. Now, he didn't have to do her like this, but he chose to do it. Now, does that mean he's going to choose to do everyone like this? No, it's at the will of Jesus Christ. Let his will be done. So as I was commanding spirit husband to pack its load and leave, she said, suddenly she saw a monkey-like figure, and it was packing a load, and it left. I said, praise the Lord. Now, for God's reason, he chose to show that to that young woman. Now, not all the time God's going to do that now, because the main thing, God wants us to receive what he do for us through and by faith. Faith in his word. So here, the Holy Spirit, the Apostle Paul, is letting you and I know that God is the one who guards us and keep us firm and steady in his word, and guard us from the evil one. He protects us from the evil one. He's our stronghold. He's our defense. He's our high tower. Praise the Lord. Then it says in verse 4, yes, united with the Lord, we are confident about you. See, the Apostle Paul was telling the believers in Thessalonians that you're only united with the Lord now. United with the Lord, they were confident that things was okay with them. So you say, yes, united with the Lord, we are confident about you. United, as long as they stay united with the Lord now, you get that? United with the Lord, he said that they are confident about them. Why? Because again, God guards them and keep them firm in his word. He said that you are doing the things we are telling you to do. See, what was the thing the apostles told them to do was the very same thing that Jesus told the apostles to do. Praise the living God. So the Apostle Paul was telling the believers in Thessalonians, as well as us today, that as long as we stay united with the Lord, then he have confidence that we are still doing the same things that he told us to do. Even now, Now, when Apostle Paul first wrote this letter, I don't know how many years ago, but it was thousands of years ago. I don't know. 1500 years, 2000, I don't know how long, but it's been a long time since he wrote this letter. And the same spirit that was speaking this to Paul then, the same spirit is still speaking today, because this is the spirit of God's word who never died. And still, the Holy Spirit, the Apostle Paul, is saying to you and I, as long as we are united with the Lord, he is still confident about us that we are doing the things that he have told us to do, and that we will keep on doing them. And what are those things that he told us to do? And being obedient and submitted to God. Paul and the apostles spoke on Jesus Christ and him crucified. Praise the living God. The kingdom, they taught on the kingdom of God. You know? And the Holy Spirit is still telling us today. In other words, what are we hearing? Are we still hearing the word of God? Dear heart, only the word of God can keep us firm in Jesus Christ. Only hearing the word of God. It's something about the word of God. The word of God can sink deep down in our heart, in our spirit, for it become a part of us, and therefore we'll know our Father's voice, and then the stranger voice we will not follow. Verse 5, it say, may the Lord direct your hearts into God's love and the perseverance which the Messiah gives. See, Jesus make us patient. He make us be able to be long-suffering, because he's long-suffering. He will direct our heart as long as we keep our mind affection directed on him. Okay? Again, we're talking about warning against joblessness, idleness. Now, you probably say, well, Francis King, what did this have to do with idleness so far? What you said, it have a lot to do. Idleness is a mindset which don't do anything. See, we got to do something. We have to keep our mind on the Lord. Keep our mind on the Lord. As like I said, idleness means joblessness. See, Jesus Christ, he do give us a job, dear heart. Now I'm talking about a spiritual job. Good thing about the job that Jesus give us, we're able to do this job on a physical job. While we're on our physical job, the Lord will enable us to do our spiritual job. Look how so many people on your job who are in the kingdom of darkness, and they need to see someone whose life practices is according to the word of God. You know, there needs to be a light amongst that darkness so that they be able to see their way clearly in prospering in every area of their life. Every child of God is not meant to come off their job, dear heart. Matter of fact, it's going to be a very few that God gonna particularly command for them to come off their job. Remember now, there is a demon spirit of joblessness, and he will convince the child of God and even tell you that he is God and instruct you, order you to come off your job. Only find out when you come off your job, you know, probably about a month, everything seems to be okay. But when those bills start piling up, then you start getting concerned. Oh, no my funding coming in to help take care of your bill. And then the devil will tell you, you got to have patience. You got to have patience. And you say, yeah, Lord, I got to have patience. See, you got to be careful. See, demons know the word of God, but they twist the word of God. If God indeed command us to come off our job, dear heart, he will make a way. There will just be no sorrow added to it, regardless of what anyone say. There'll be no sorrow added to it. God will take care and supply instantly all of your needs, because he's the one who told you to come off that job, you know. So he's going to make a way, you know. But Satan deceives us in saying that, no, you, by saying, I have to have patience. You know, God teaching my patience. God teaching me to to believe him. So I'm gonna keep believing him. And I'm talking about those. There's nothing. I mean, you young, There's nothing physically wrong with you. But you say God told you to come off your job, and you all you're doing is idling. You know, I mean, you're just doing nothing. You know, that's not God, dear heart. That's that demon spirit of joblessness, idleness. Verse 6, he say, now, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we command you, brothers. Wow. You heard that? Now, this is the first time I've really seen where a servant of God is commanding the human spirit. Now, we command demon spirits, but the Holy Spirit, the Apostle Paul, is commanding human spirits, the human being. He said, now, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, all the other apostles as well, command you, believers, remember, brothers, believers, to stay away from any brother or believer who is leading a life of idleness or joblessness, a life not in keeping with the tradition you receive from the tradition you receive from the Holy Spirit through them. Because remember, the traditions that Paul and the apostles taught the people was only the traditions that they received of the Holy Spirit. It was not their tradition. It was the traditions of God, the commands of God. So do you hear what the Holy Spirit is telling us here? If you know a brother and sister, a brother or sister who is physically able to work, there's just nothing wrong with them whatsoever that's hindering them from working, but they say, well, the Lord told me to quit my job and work in the ministry full time. And you see that person, you say, okay, but you know what you need to do? Withdraw from that person. This is what the word of God say, withdraw from that person. Because that person is living a life of idleness, a life of joblessness. Because you'll find out later on what the Apostle Paul continued to say concerning a person who refused to work, refused to actually earn a living to help themselves. Because you cannot help a person if they're not trying to help themselves. See, if Satan can't trick you one way, he'll trick you another way. He'll trick you. There have been a lot of people, men and women, especially believers, that God have blessed in the workforce, because that's where God placed them for his reason. For them to prosper, not only for them to prosper, but for them to prosper to help others to prosper as well. And they were doing great for the Lord. But Satan did not like that. So he had to come up with his cunning plan and purpose and idea and offer a suggestion to them and pretend to be God by telling them, quit your job and work in the ministry full time. So they go to their leader or whoever and say, you know, I hear God's voice. He want me to quit my job and go to ministry full time. He say, amen, brother. I think you should too. I mean, you'll be great in the ministry. So the brother will quit his job, knowing he got responsibility. Quit his job. Tell his wife, we got to go by faith now. We got to live by faith. And the wife, quite now, she's not... fully, totally submit to God on her own, so she's going to believe the devil through her husband and say, okay, because the first thing the devil would say to the wife, you ain't supporting your husband. And then that thing, you know, a month is fine, but after that, things start piling up, and the wife says, okay, honey, you know, and the devil's telling the wife now, don't pressure your husband. You're not having faith. You're really hindering his ministry. So the wife not going to say nothing to the husband. They tell the husband, you got to have faith in God. And they're the husband, knowing that bills piling up, you know, children don't have no food to eat, rent is due, or the mortgage is due. And then all of a sudden, you know, you got to return your car, you got to return your house, you got to, You got to return whatever else you got. Debt is piling up. Their heart, that is not God. And next thing you know, confusion coming in between you and your wife. You know, next thing you know, she's leaving you. That's not God. That was that demon spirit of idleness, of joblessness. You know, this put me in mind of many years ago, early part of my husband and I marriage. Now, the demon spirit of joblessness attacked us. Now, I'm telling you this from experience as well as from the word of God. And my husband and I, we had lost a job, so we looked at it and a blessing from God. We can be in ministry full time. And here we had these little children. Our three children were under the age 10 and under, all three children. But no, we both, you know, God worked this thing out. We lost our job, you know, God worked this thing out. He wants us to be in ministry full time. So when you looked at our circumstances, we had no money, no funding coming in. Quite naturally, we didn't have no church. Praise God, we didn't raise up a church. It really would end up being terrible. Because, see, you're going to pay for misleading other people. And, but my husband and I, you know, we still was believing. We weren't where we should be in the Lord. We was taking man's word instead of getting in the word of God for ourselves. And our children suffer. They lack a lot. I never forget the time I was going over my grandmother's house, and my second daughter, I think she was around 8 at the time, had a bicycle. We were so jobless that her bike didn't have no rim on, didn't have no tire on it, just a rim. And she was riding it down the street like it was a tire on the bicycle. And then all of a sudden I heard the voice of the Lord say, Terry, look at your daughter. I looked at my daughter, dear heart, my heart ached. My heart ached. And it's like I heard the Lord say, Terry, this don't have to be. I did. I heard the Lord say, this don't have to be. Just see my daughter. My daughter just as happy as she can be riding on her bicycle without any rubber tire, just the rim, I think, the wheel that don't have the rubber tire. She was happy, but I knew that wasn't the will of God. It really wasn't my will. My will for her to have the whole bicycle. And that thing hurt me. And it's like I could hear Lord say, Terry, just like he hurt you to see your daughter like that, he hurt me to see you and your family like that. And then that's when I asked the Lord to forgive me. And then I asked the Lord, Lord, you know, help us to find a job. And my husband and I, we had to battle against that demon spirit of joblessness and poverty, especially demon spirit of joblessness in our daughter. We first had to realize that it wasn't God who instructed us to not to work a job. Because God has his time for everything. And at that time, it wasn't our time to be to go out into full-time ministry. It wasn't our time. We wasn't equipped spiritually to handle the task anyway. Some of you who are jobless right now, who call yourself quitting to go into full-time ministry, you're not equipped yet to handle the spiritual task that God will set before you. You're not spiritually equipped yet. And I could see very clear and well now that then my husband and I was not spiritually equipped. Praise the living God. So anyway, continuing with that story, we went to this camp, and because with God's instruction, he wanted to teach us some things. We went to the camp. That's the only good thing that came out of being jobless, came out of not having a job, was when we went to this camp and the Lord taught us and showed us some things and really taught us how to come against the spirit of joblessness and also the spirit of idleness and poverty. So that was a good thing that came out of attending that camp. Well, while we was at the camp, I'm going to show you how the devil tried another trick of his own trade to try to get us to believe and to accept that was God's will. It was this young so-called prophet, and I knew he wasn't a prophet of God, but everybody called him a prophet. And I knew the man, by the Holy Spirit now, I knew this thing. And I also knew that the man's house was not in order. I also knew by the Holy Spirit that he precious his wife, that he really had delegated his responsibility as being the man or head of the house. He had really delegated or given that authority to his wife. He shipped that authority to his wife. So the Lord told me that that spirit in him wanted to do me the same way. Shift my husband's responsibility as being head of the house. See, some of you men think all the time it's the woman's fault as far as look, as appearing to be or look like she's the head of the house. 10 out of 10, it ain't the woman's fault. It's the man's fault because of his failure and unwillingness to serve in the position, no role that God had placed him in as husband and head of that house. So he called himself one day, giving my husband a word, and he told me, I want to give your wife a word. My husband said, okay. So my husband came to me, and out of honor and respect towards my husband, for my husband, I went. That's the only reason why I went, because I knew that young man was not a true prophet of God, but out of respect for my husband, I went. So when I went, and he started talking, and he said, sister, he said, because at that time, remember, my husband and I were jobless. Praise the Lord. The Lord had opened up my mind's understanding to let me see how the demon spirit of joblessness has tricked and fooled us in convincing us to give up our jobs and not to even seek employment. Now, there's a difference of being jobless when you cannot find a job yet. Notice I say yet. No, this is a person in their heart have given up on even seeking a job, given up on either desiring a job. So this so-called prophet looked at me and said, sister, I said, mm-hmm. He said, I see you working and you got a good paying job. I said, okay, God did tell me that. Okay, God did tell me that. But then he said, and I see your husband in full-time ministry. I said, no. That was a lie. I said, no. He looked at me. I said, no. No, that is not so. And that young man looked at me and walked away. Now, you probably said that was defiant, very defiant against the devil. The devil is a lie. I'm telling you what the devil wanted to do. See, the devil wanted me to receive that where my husband, responsibility as being the head or man of the house, that role and responsibility would have shifted to me, where I would be bringing in the money for the home, you see, instead of him. And that would end up creating a lot of problem because I refuse to have that position shift onto me because I am his helpmate. I am not built in the spirit or in the physical. I am not built to handle that responsibility. And if I would have received it, it would have killed me, you see. Some of you don't understand that, but you'll understand it one day. See, God had ordained responsibility for the husband and the wife. So the wife cannot shift her responsibility onto the husband. The husband cannot shift his responsibility onto the wife. As for being the head of the house, the provider of the home, it coming through and by the husband. The wife can help. She can be a help meet to help, but to solely put all that responsibility on her, that's too much pressure, and it will cause that woman to lapse. She will lapse mentally, spiritually, and physically, and emotionally. Okay? So anyway, that so-called prophet, he left. Do you not know, late on that evening, the Lord fits it so someone came to us and mentioned about this, what they saw that this prophet, so-called prophet done. So his wife, she works. She the one who works. He don't work. As a matter of fact, Daryl, he called himself working full-time ministry. All he was doing at that summer camp is looking around, looking for people he can prophesy to. And they said that he went to his wife and said, honey, give me $100 for an offering. So the money she makes, she has to pay all the bills plus give him money for offering. Now, that is not God. This is, again, warning against joblessness. It's a demon spirit of idleness, of joblessness. Okay? So we have to obey God. And actually, the Holy Spirit, the Apostle Paul, was warning those in Thessalonians because the believers, now these are believers in Christ Jesus, there was those who was doing this same act, these same acts. Satan had deceived them. Verse 7 says, for you yourselves know how you must imitate us, that we were not idle when we were among you. See, the apostle Paul and the other apostles were not idle. They was doing the work of God. And not only was they doing spiritually the work of God, but they also did physical labor as well. So they set them an example in not to become idle or joblessness. Praise the living God. So we did not accept anyone's food without paying. You see, so that they couldn't say, yeah, Paul, apostle was, oh my, did you see how much he eat, girl? He won't work. Well, he said we should feed him. No. No, the apostle Paul said, we got food and we paid for it. Praise the living God. He said, on the contrary, we labor and toil. They work day and night, working so as not to be a burden to any of you. See, that's the blessing of God. The blessing of God upon someone, you would not be a burden upon someone else. If you say that the Lord told you to quit your job, then you would not become a burden on someone else. If you become a burden on someone else, then that means that that was not God who told you to quit that job. That was the demon spirit of joblessness, the demon spirit of idleness, not God. Because God would not allow you to be a burden on anyone else. If God is the one who told you to quit your job, God will provide. He's not going to cause you to rely on your mom, your dad, your uncle, your brother, your sister, your neighbor, or whoever. No. If you become, every time they see you, they say, oh no, here they come. They so need it. Talking about God told them to quit their job. They're always needing something. What do they want now? They see you coming, they'll try to hide. They you call them, they look on the call ID. I know what they want. That's not God. God was not the one who told you to quit your job, dear heart. When God tells you, you're not going to be a burden on anybody. You hear me? Don't believe the devil by telling you, well, you got to be tested and tried. No, that is not true. When God tells you to quit your job, you have already proven, you already been tested, you already been tried. And that's why God said, okay, I need for you to go forth into full-time ministry. I shall supply all your need. Amen. You know, I listened to the testimony of Lester Sumrall when the Lord told him for the first time to be an evangelist and go to other countries. He never been there. He didn't have no money. But God told him to do it. Do you not know God made a way? Every step of that young man's life, God miraculously made a way. That's what God would do when God instructs us to do something. But if we become a burden on someone, then that's clue and hint right there that God did not tell us to become joblessness. Praise the living God. Verse 9, he say, it was not that we haven't the right to be supported, he said, but so that we could make ourselves an example to imitate. See, the apostles made themselves as an example to imitate, that they were not joblessness. They were not idle. So therefore, we imitate them as they imitated Christ Jesus, because Jesus was not jobless and he was not idle. Jesus did not become a burden on anyone. The apostles did not become a burden on anyone. We should not become a burden on anyone. Praise the living God. Verse 10, for even when we were with you, we gave you this commandment. You hear that? The apostle Father, our Holy Spirit said, now when we were with you, this is what we told you. Because I'm telling you, Even during the Paul's time, believers was doing that. They was idle. They was joblessness. They were saying that Jesus told me to quit my job. And they was idle. Becoming burdens on husband, actually husband becoming burden on their wives. The wives becoming a burden on their husband. The children becoming a burden on their parents. Then the whole family become a burden on their other family members. They was doing that then, and they doing this, that today. So, Apostle Paul said, we gave you this commandment when we were with you. They said, if someone won't work, he shouldn't eat. You hear that? If you don't work, you don't eat. If you're gonna choose to be idle and jobless, then you won't eat. Now, that's the commandment that the apostles gave those who were not jobless and those who was not idle to those who were. Don't work. Don't eat. Don't expect me to be calling you for dinner. Don't you expect me to be going to the grocery store? Oh, yeah, such such don't work. So let me get them something. Don't expect that. No, you don't work. You don't eat. That's why, again, when the Lord himself, you know, it struck us to quit our job. He provides our every need. We go to him when we are in need, and he will touch hearts to give. I mean, you just won't become so needy. You know, when you're around people, people won't dread to see you, won't dread to hear you because you're not needed. You know, always around asking, you know. You have, actually have your way of asking by looking pitiful, you know, making a person feel guilty if they don't help you. Because after all, they know you are in full-time ministry and you know you don't have this, you don't have that. That is not God. So the commandment that Apostle Paul and the apostles gave the brethren in Thessalonians, if a man don't work, then a man will not eat. Praise the living God. Verse 11, he say, we hear that some of you are leaving a life of idleness. See, those words got back to Apostle Paul and the apostles. There was believers that was talking about other believers who was living a lifestyle of joblessness and idleness. Not busy working, just busy bodies. Busy bodies. Those words got back to Apostle Paul and the other apostles. And the Holy Spirit through him was correcting. See, dear heart, the Lord corrects who he loved. He chastens, which is he corrects who he loved. If you say, quite naturally, you love God and you know God loves you, so expect him to correct you. If he doesn't correct you, he don't love you. Because when a father actually loves his son or his child, he will correct them. So expect to be corrected of God. Why? Because he loves you. Because he loves you. Verse 12, we command such people. What people? Those leading a life of joblessness, idleness. We command such people. And in union with the Lord Jesus, we urge you. We urge you to settle down, get to work, and earn their own living. Do you not see this? That the believers in Paul's day is doing the very same thing. It tells you it's a demon spirit. It's the same demon spirit at work. Joblessness, idleness is a demon spirit, which gets you to do nothing. Absolute nothing, just to be idle. And you know, when something is idle and fruitless and don't produce anything, after a while it's going to be hewn down. It's going to be chopped down. So there's a danger about being joblessness and idle. Okay? Forgive us, Lord. So again, the Lord is urging us to settle down, to get to work, and earn our own living. Don't expect someone else to take care of you. Don't expect the system to take care of you. Praise the living God. Only your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who really and truly cares for you. Verse 13, and you brothers who are doing what is good, don't slack off. Don't slack off. Continue to do what is good. You believers who are doing what is good, the Lord say, don't slack off. Don't look at that one believer who's living a lifestyle of joblessness and idleness and say, I want to be just like them. Man, I don't have to work a regular job. I can just go into full-time ministry, collect tithes and offering, and that'll sustain me. Oh, don't you do that, because you don't know or see their reward that they are getting and will receive. That's dangerous. So the Lord warned us, we who are doing good, don't slack off. Obey the Lord thy God. Keep your eyes and fix on him. Your example, or our example, is Jesus Christ. He's our example. We need to ask ourselves, was he idle? Was he jobless? No, he was not. He done the work with God. He was a carpenter. Jesus was a carpenter. Remember that. He was a carpenter. Praise the living God. 14. Furthermore, if anyone does not obey what we are saying in this letter, this was a letter. So this is the same letter today. You know, that's good. Let's tell you that that letter was inspired by the Holy Spirit, because we're still reading that same letter today. God is awesome. He said, if anyone does not obey what we are saying in this letter, take note of him and have nothing to do with him, so that he will be ashamed. No, don't have nothing to do with people who are jobless and idle. They choose to be. They choose to be busybody. Busy, not busy working. Not busy doing the things of God. Just idle. Just always tending in other people's business and affairs and relating to you messages. You know, you don't have nothing to do with those people, because that spirit of joblessness and idleness will jump onto you and cause you to become the same. You separate yourselves from such people. 15, but don't consider him an enemy. Right, you don't consider them an enemy, because they're not an enemy, because the enemy is the one you cannot see with your eye. But as far as their works, which are unfruitful, you have nothing to do with them, with that. He said, on the contrary, confront him as a brother or sister and try to help him change. Dear heart, that's true. Now, a lot of times when you try, I have done that twice so far. Confronted my dear brethren as far as saying that God told them to quit their job and be in full-time ministry. I confronted them and shared with them this word, the word of God, and they did not receive. Matter of fact, they called me every name but a child of God, really. So therefore, the Lord, you know, I did my part. So the Lord said, just wipe the dust off your feet when you've done the right thing. Because, you know, when you see your brother and sister in error, you know, love who is Christ Jesus in you, just... you got to just warn them. You warn them because of love in you. You warn them. Because a true friend is not someone who tells you what you want to hear all the time. A true friend tells you what you need to hear all the time. Okay? So you do your part in doing what is right. If they choose not to change, then you do your part. And then when you come face to face with the Lord, then their blood would not be on your hands. You see? So praise the Lord. 16, he said, now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace always and always. The Lord be with all of you. Amen. And I pray that the Lord Jesus be with all of you, dear heart, that you heard the Holy Spirit talk to you through this message, warning against joblessness, which is against idleness. Dear heart, know your Father's voice. And the voice of the stranger you will not follow. I want to thank you for tuning in today on Holy Spirit Talk, Delivered, Healing, and Prayer. Now remember, Holy Spirit Talk, Delivered, Healing, and Prayer is a production of Mike Works Radio. The Word of God spoken with and power of the Holy Ghost. Remember, it drives out demons. And Mike Works Radio is a broadcast of messages spoken and hosted by Mrs. Terry B. King, also known as Evangelist King. Now, as you listen and meditate on God's spoken word, be sure to meditate and listen on God's spoken word. The Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit does, he will flush out every spirit that is not of him. And it would give you a clean sweep. You know, when a wife sweep her house, a clean sweep from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. In Jesus' name. That's what the Holy Spirit does as you listen to Holy Spirit talk. Just meditate upon what you hear. Even after the broadcast, you go back and you re-listen. As you read the Word of God and allow the Holy Spirit to saturate your mind and just savor your mind in the Word of God. And your mind will come out to be renewed, refreshed in Jesus' name. So, dear heart, get prepared for a Holy Ghost showdown as you continue to tune in to Holy Spirit talk. Now, remember now, dear heart, we are on the go in Jesus' name. You can go to your Apple or Android market and download our free app, The Children's Mic. Just key in The Children's Mic and you can download the free app. Also, dear heart, now you're able to listen to Holy Spirit talk on Mike Works Radio by phone, your mobile or landline phone. You can dial two numbers. It's radio 24/7. You can dial 415-325-0729 or 716-748-0762. So we praise the Lord for those few opportunities that he has given us on Mike Works Radio, Holy Spirit Talk. So again, dear heart, remember to tune in at our live broadcast. Now, this is a live broadcast where I'm broadcasting straight from my home. So it includes errors and everything, because that's the way I am. And I come on live every Monday and Friday, 12 noon Eastern Standard Time. So remember to tune in and visit our website at thechildrensmic.org for the many other program. And dear heart, feel free to send me an email at mikeworks@thechildrensmic.org and give me a list of subjects that you would love for me to minister on. And as the Holy Spirit lead me to choose your subject, then I will bring a message on that subject. Because I really like to do things according to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. So I want to thank all of you all who have been letting me know that you've been tuning in to Holy Spirit Talk. The archived messages that really have truly blessed your soul. And I thank you for being an encouragement to me. It's like every time that the Satan attacked me to try to get me to feel discouraged and giving up on speaking these messages. It's like God does it every time. Remember now, I'm human just like you are. You know, I have temptations just like you are. Remember, this is a work of faith. Now, you get to see me. You get to hear me. But I don't get to see or hear you. Every now and then, now the Lord is blessing me to be able to hear or see people as they come out to our healing and deliverance service every first Saturday of the month. And it's a blessing. But every now and then, dear heart, I get a little disheartened because I'm like, it's hard to see the fruit of my labor. So by faith, I must believe. And every time the enemy attacked me like that, it's like the Lord always sends someone at the right time to send me a message. And I'd be like, wow, Lord, this is why the devil is trying to get me to stop. Look what you are doing. Praise the living God. So, dear heart, encourage me. Send me your emails of encouragement to let me know what God is continuing to do in your life after you hear the broadcast messages. Or even after, you know, the Holy Spirit through me have conducted a deliverance session. Give me feedback of encouragement. encourage me. You have, just like I encourage you, you must encourage me. So I need to hear it because it encouraged me to keep on keeping on. Praise the living God. So dear heart, remember as always, in your getting, be sure you get understanding. Shalom.